So I got kind of a hokey title of my talk here, The Good, the Bad, and the Beautiful. I remember that was just a takeoff of the movie, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, spaghetti western from the 60s. But they're not ugly. These mushrooms are actually quite beautiful. And there's some other beautiful aspects, I think, to the whole story about the amanita toxin. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the bad, but I think you've already heard enough about that. I think the message has come across pretty well now that these things are bad for you. But then I want to talk about the good aspects of amanita mushrooms and how, in fact, they're quite interesting and have some actual practical applications that could maybe compensate for all the misery they've caused over the millennia. Okay, so the introduction to the amanita, you've heard about this already. I want to make 2 points, though, on this slide that maybe I made. It's a very large genus. There are over 700 species in this genus, and only a handful of them in one particular section produce these nasty toxins that are so deadly. And that's an interesting evolutionary question right there, is why is it that only some of the species have the capacity to make the toxins? And how did that evolve, and how is it persisting? And to answer, partly to answer that question, we went and identified the genes that make the toxins. I'll tell you about that in a bit. Another aspect of these fungi that is more of a nuisance than anything from my point of view is you can't cultivate them. They will not grow in the laboratory in any way, shape, or form. If you put them on a petri plate, you give them every possible nutrient you can think of, they just don't budge. After a month, they've grown maybe in half an inch. And this, from an experimentalist point of view, because I'm trying to work with them as an experimental system, is extremely annoying. But it's a fact of life. That means that if you want these material to work with, you have to go out in the woods and collect the mushrooms. And that is hazardous. It's hazardous because you don't know when they're going to come up or where they're going to come up exactly. Phylloides can be very abundant locally. Phylloides here on the left. But it doesn't grow in Michigan. What we have there instead are Amanita bisporigera. This one here, this small white one, but when they grow, they're quite a bit scarcer. They don't come up very much during the course of the year. These amatoxins, these poisonous compounds that these mushrooms make, account for more than 95% of all the fatalities. They're really very nasty, as you've heard, for several reasons. Now, a couple of major points is that they're very resistant to any kind of cooking. And when they're absorbed into your liver cells, they recirculate within you. And so they don't get to the kidneys where they can be excreted. They continue to do their damage. So, first, the beautiful. This is a picture out of an article by Ann Pringle. And Ben Wolf, just to show you a little bit of the variety of amanita genus, they really are strikingly different. Here are some of the amanitas that I collected as part of our project some years ago in Northern California. Again, they're big, bold, dramatic-looking mushrooms. Now, even the white ones, I think, are quite attractive. These are amanita bisporigera, pure white ones called by the common name Destroying Angel, growing in Michigan. Okay, so one question that I really want to spend some time on is the question that I get asked more often than any other, which is, why do the mushrooms make these toxins? From a biological point of view, we want to ask, what selective advantage do these compounds confer? There are lots and lots of examples of poisons out there. A lot of plants are poisonous. A lot of animals make venoms, scorpions, snakes, etc. But in the case of the mushrooms, it's actually been an ongoing mystery. We really don't know the answer to it, about why they make them. But I wanted to explore some possible answers to that question. Partly because in order to understand why these mushrooms might be making these toxins, it helps to understand which organisms are sensitive or not. And again, you run into this gigantic literature, lots and lots of anecdotes. And you can read in all sorts of natural history books that such and such animals can eat them or can't eat them, and these organisms are sensitive or those are sensitive. Almost none of it, which is backed up by any good experimental evidence. I'm going to stand over here, maybe I can read the slides. So I wanted to go through what my understanding is, and I'm sure people here know a lot about this also. We know that there are many reports of dogs and humans being poisoned by them, dogs in particular, probably cats, too. There are a couple of articles in literature that cats. showing symptoms of amatoxin poisoning, so probably cats. The rodents are sensitive. All the original chemical work on these toxins was done by injecting the toxins into mice and rats. So we know if you inject them in the rodents, they die. But that doesn't tell us if the rodents can eat them or not. And I don't know of any good evidence for or against that. But then rabbits, cows, rabbits, you know, ungulates, all different kinds of animals, which ones can survive and which ones can't. I could find an old report from 1944 where somebody force-fed a rabbit amanita verrosa and the rabbit died. And this is a one-off experiment that's hardly gotten much legitimacy. We don't know how much it ate. We don't know how happy the rabbit really died of. And the same person fed a calf and the calf survived. Well, again, a calf would take a lot bigger dose than a rabbit. Well, in the whole ecosystem out there, the predominant herbivores and the creatures that really put most pressure on fungi and plants would be the insects. Gastropods also, perhaps. I think anybody who's spent any time collecting mushrooms has seen a lot of slugs and snails. And you pick up a beautiful-looking specimen and see a slug on it, and you throw it away because, well, kind of disgusting. Well, thanks to YouTube, there are lots of pictures and movies, great movies online, about all sorts of animals eating all sorts of mushrooms. Here's a squirrel eating a mushroom. Now, you can't tell what it is. It's pretty clearly not an amanita, not a deadly poisonous amanita. But how can a squirrel tell a poisonous from a non-poisonous mushroom? At least to humans, they have no smell, no particular taste, the toxins. There's pictures of turtles eating mushrooms, which is amazing. So maybe these toxins are anti-turtle, you know, but then again, when you think about the big scheme of things, it's hard to believe that turtles are exerting much selective pressure on mushrooms in general. There's a really great picture of a coyote eating what is clearly an Amanita muscaria. So Amanita muscaria does not make the potent amatoxins, the really deadly toxins, but it does make other toxic things, and so I don't recommend anyone eat Amanita muscaria. Other Amanitas make other things that cause, you know, severe gastrointestinal distress, but not the deadly ones. Now, and then there's also, I like this picture because it's a beetle going to town on a mushroom having a great old time. And all of these, first of all, these, we don't know what these mushrooms are. And even muscaria doesn't make the toxins. Another thing you don't know is what happened to these animals afterwards, right? I mean, maybe they died a horrible death 5 days later, and you don't know. So this kind of information is interesting, but unfortunately far from definitive. There's lots of other anecdotal, not such reliable literature, like children's books, you know, that elephants turn green when they eat Amanita, or it must be Amanita muscaria. We don't know. But sometimes, of course, poisonous mushrooms have been used to move along the chain of inheritance. You know, there are certain stories of people poisoning each other in order to get to the throne, so you don't know what the barba's up to, maybe more than we admit. So here's a mushroom that I collected in Michigan. All I can tell you, and I apologize, I know that I didn't pick it, but somebody ripped off the base, right, which is a real no-no. So this is a white amanita, and there are clearly slugs on it, one on the top and one on the stalk there that have been chewing on it and eating on it. So I brought these slugs back to the laboratory, put them in a glass dish with the mushroom, and I watched them for a week. I wanted to know, were they going to die or not? Well, they didn't die. They spent their whole time trying to escape the glass jar. They wouldn't even, I couldn't even observe them eating the mushroom anymore. They had their fill of it. And so, to answer this question, whether these slugs are ever going to die or not, there are two critical things you have to know. One is, did that particular mushroom have the toxins in there or not? Even if we got the species right, not every mushroom always has the toxins. And second of all, of course, did the slug survive or not? So it's still a very open question, but I think it's an important one about why these mushrooms make the toxins. Probably not to kill mammals. They're very poor deterrents. They have no bad taste, at least to humans. They have no bad smell, so they don't discourage you from eating them in the first place. And because the effects take so long to occur, there's not much of a lesson to be learned, even to fascinating culturally. Someone dies, you say, what did they eat a week ago? Well, no one can remember what they ate a week ago. And so, probably not, but there's some interesting studies that have been done with flies. And John Jenicke did, a really great experiment back in 1983, that he showed that fruit flies, Drosophila, that normally eat fruit, are sensitive to the toxins. He reared them in a growth chamber and put amanitin into their food, so they're eating it. But the flies that eat mushrooms were resistant. And I think this is a critical clue about why these toxins might have evolved, namely to protect the mushrooms against fruit fly predation or herbivory. So that, as often happens in the so-called arms race between toxins in a host plant or fungus and a herbivore, it goes back and forth. The plant evolves the ability to make something toxic. The predators or herbivores respond by evolving resistance. Then the plant evolves a new toxin, back and forth. This has been seen many times evolutionarily. So some flies can still eat these mushrooms. Furthermore, Jenicke proposed that he proposed that the flies actually might even accumulate the amatoxins inside themselves for their own purposes, to protect themselves against predation by other things like wasps or against parasitic nematodes. Someday I hope to test this hypothesis. I've told John that if he ever can find some of these fruit flies I've been feeding on the mushrooms, I would like to grind them up and assay them for the levels of the toxins. Because it could be that they're accumulating. This is well known. Monarch butterflies do this, for example. They accumulate compounds from milkweed that make them unpalatable to blue jays. So this could be an interesting angle on the overall ecological function of these compounds. Although it still doesn't tell us why the mushrooms started to make them in the first place. Or it could just be that the toxins, are simply toxic to slugs or snails or nematodes directly that might parasitize on the mushrooms. So it's still an open question, and I think there's still some interesting research that could be done on this question. All right, so now I want to talk about the good side of these mushroom toxins from the point of view of practical applications, hard as that may be. You have to remember, though, that when we talk about beneficial drugs like antibiotics, we're really talking about poisons. Beneficial antibiotics are poisonous to bacteria. The whole key to things like antibiotics is selectivity, that they kill the bad things but not the good things. They kill the pathogen but not the host. So poisons and beneficial drugs are two sides of the same coin. And when a pharmacologist is trying to develop a new drug, they have several things in mind, several properties that those drugs have to have. First of all, they have to be very chemically stable, so they can be made and stored and survive, and especially orally consumed drugs have to survive the digestive tract. They have to be readily taken up by cells. And they have to inhibit some essential target. Penicillin, for example, inhibits cell wall synthesis in bacteria, an essential process. And they have to be highly specific to avoid side effects. Now, these are all exactly the properties that the amatoxins have. They can survive any kind of cooking. They survive the digestive tract. They're taken up very rapidly by liver cells. They inhibit an essential enzyme. They're very highly specific. So all we have to do, I know it's a tall order, is flip this around. And if we could just make an amatoxin with a slightly different target, we might end up with a powerfully new drug rather than a deadly poison. And this has, in fact, been done in exactly this way. A company in Germany took an antibody that was specific for a cancer cell. So a cancer cell shows certain proteins on their surface. And they made an antibody against one of those very specific proteins, and they coupled it to the amanitin molecule. When they inject that into a person with cancer, it circulates. It finds the cancer cells, gloms onto them. The cancer cells take it up, release the amanitin, and kill themselves. So the cancer cells commit suicide, basically. And because that antibody is so highly specific, you kill only the cancer cells and not the regular cells. So this was a big paper in 2015. They call these antibody-drug conjugates. There have been many different drugs proposed for these antibody-drug conjugate kinds of things. But a manitin has a number of properties that make it particularly good as the so-called warhead for these ATC compounds. And it worked very well in rats. So that's where it is right now. High antitumoral activity. And they've now conjugated a manitin to a number of different antibodies specific for different kinds of cancer. So it could be a very broadly applicable approach. Now, from a mycological perspective, I'd like to raise this point here. The only current source of manitin is mushrooms collected in the wild. You can't cultivate the mushrooms. You can't chemically synthesize it. It's becoming complicated. So what's going to happen if these drugs start getting into clinical trials, much less actual commercial production? There's going to be a tremendous demand for manitin. And there's going to be people scouring the streets of Vancouver. And every time a mushroom pops up, they're going to grab it and run off, extract it, and sell it to somebody. Sigma sells alpha manitin. It's $140 a milligram, right? So that's $140,000 a kilogram. It's pretty valuable stuff. Maybe people are familiar with the story of Taxol. It comes from the Pacific yew trees. A number of years ago, when Taxol was showing great promise as an anti-cancer drug, there was serious concern that the yew trees would go extinct because people would be stripping them off for their bark for the compound. Well, that's one reason that the NIH is supporting our work on the biosynthetic pathway of this. So that's one good thing. Now, the other aspect of it, I want to get a little technical here. I'm going to start talking about structures and things because there's just no way around it. So you've seen the structure already. Steve broke you in a little bit here by showing you the structure of alpha manitin. It's this molecule here. Now, this molecule is a highly specific inhibitor of this thing here. And this, what this is a gigantic enzyme called RNA polymerase II. And this is an incredibly important enzyme. And alpha-manitin is a defining inhibitor of this specific enzyme. Defining inhibitor means that it inhibits this enzyme and no other. So if you study this enzyme, you're going to be buying and using a lot of alpha-manitin as a very specific inhibitor. And this is a phenomenally important enzyme that every single cell out there has. What it does is it takes DNA. DNA comes in here, double-stranded DNA. And this enzyme moves along the chromosome, moves along the DNA strand. And what it does is it makes a copy of it, a single-stranded copy called messenger RNA, shown in red there. It has to unwind the strand, which is topologically right there, a pretty complicated story. It unwinds it and then it rewinds it here. And then this single-stranded messenger RNA comes off, and that goes into the cytoplasm where it gets translated into proteins. So without this enzyme, the cells can't make a copy of their DNA. They can't read the DNA. It'd be like having a library and no access, no key to the library, or not being able to read at all. It'd be completely, all the information in the DNA is completely useless except for this enzyme can read it. And it makes a messenger RNA copy. So if this enzyme gets inhibited, then RNA synthesis grinds to a halt. Protein synthesis grinds to a halt. The cells can't regenerate their proteins and keep growing and the cells die. And they know exactly, because they have the entire structure of this gigantic enzyme solid, and they know exactly where alpha-manitin sits in right here and blocks the activity of this. This is what RNA polymerase looks like. Roger Kornberg won the Nobel Prize for figuring out the structure of this enzyme. It's a gigantic enzyme, and this is only showing the backbone of the polypeptide chain in 11 subunits. It's a massive thing. And that's where alpha-manitin tucks in there just perfectly. And they know exactly every contact that it makes. It has to have exactly the right structure to bind the polymerase and do everything. Let's see if I can get this to work. So if you're the kind of person, the kind of protein crystallographer who studies things like this, you have these programs that can show you everything. You can zoom in on it in exactly every detail. You can take out atoms, add atoms, look at every single contact point between the molecule. Okay, so another good aspect of this. So to summarize, basically what happens is the mushrooms have evolved a way to make this compound. When an organism consumes it orally, it enters the intestinal tract, gets absorbed into the blood, goes into the liver, goes into the liver cells. In each liver cell, it enters the nucleus, binds this enzyme, binds to that specific spot, and that's why it's eventually the host dies. Now, these mushrooms do other interesting things. We are screening them for their antibacterial activity. There's a big demand, a big need for more newer antibiotics, especially against all of the strains of bacteria that are evolving that are resistant to the known antibiotics. And mushrooms have proven themselves to be good sources of antibiotic-type compounds, poisonous compounds. And sure enough, ammonite of bisperidura, the amatoxin-producing one, is shown here, is pretty good at inhibiting a major pathogen called Staphylococcus aureus. This is an attenuated strain that's safe to work with, but some versions of Staph aureus now have become resistant to almost all known antibiotics. So this is another potentially good aspect. We don't know what this active compound is yet, but I'm pretty sure it's not alpha-manitin, because alpha-manitin only affects eukaryotic cells like plants and animals and other fungi. It doesn't affect bacteria. So there's something else in these mushrooms. One of the frustrations we have is the fact that these are all ammonite of bisperidura, different specimens. And you see some of them have the active compound, like these two, maybe this one. These others don't. And this leads into the need for more studies on the taxonomy of these mushrooms so we can identify them and know which ones do or do not make compounds of interest. Okay, so a little bit more about the chemistry. What my lab does, what we've spent our last 10 years studying, is how these toxins are biosynthesized, how they're made by the fungi. And to do that, we went and identified the genes that make them. So I want to say a couple words about the chemistry of these compounds. They are bicyclic peptides. That means that they are composed of amino acids, just like proteins. Proteins are thousands of amino acids. These are only 8 amino acids. 8 amino acids, whereas normally amino acids join together in proteins in long chains, these are actually cycles. They fold back on themselves, so they form a ring. So if you're a chemist, you can take this apart quite readily and identify that as the amino acid isoleucine, tryptophan, glycine, isoleucine, glycine, cysteine, asparagine, proline, in an outer ring like that. But furthermore, they are bicyclic because the tryptophan and cysteine form a cross bridge there, so there's actually 2 loops. And this has a couple of interesting ramifications. One is that there isn't anywhere else in nature that this particular chemical linkage has ever been found. So chemists are very excited to try to figure out how this is made because it's unique, just because it's not like anything else. Second of all, this bicyclic nature makes these compounds very rigid. If this were a small linear peptide, shown like here, the 8 amino acids, it would be very floppy. The floppy molecules make bad drugs for some complex thermodynamic reasons. But when they're folded up and made rigid, then they become much more biologically active. I'll talk about the phallotoxins. It's a whole other group of compounds made by amanita mushrooms. They're quite toxic, but not when you eat them. They don't seem to be taken up by the digestive tract. But they are also bicyclic peptides. There are some variants of these. There's alpha-manitin is the major one, but there's also beta-manitin has 1 amino acid difference, and there's phallocytin, phalloidin, etc. I won't go into it, but it's interesting that phallocytin and phalloidin have a completely different mode of action. They're very toxic. They have a completely different mode of action, which is kind of an interesting story in itself. Now, cyclic peptides. Okay, so what's so cool about cyclic peptides? A lot of drugs are cyclic peptides. It's considered a very desirable pharmacological chemical space. Cyclic peptides, like I said, for a bunch of different reasons. One is, some examples, first of all, of good cyclic peptides include ergotamine, cyclosporin, and penicillin, daptomycin. These are antibiotics. This is for migraine headaches and other things. This is an immunosuppressant drug. And these are cyclic peptides. They have very strong thermal and pH stability. They're resistant to proteases. Proteases are enzymes that break down proteins, and they're everywhere. And, of course, our intestinal digestive system, they're full of proteases, will break down most any small linear peptides. But these are cyclic, so they're resistant, and they don't get... So they make it through the digestive tract. They get across membranes in the cells very readily because they're cyclic. And, as I said, they're rigid for thermodynamic reasons. Now, here's an example of a cyclic peptide. It was originally isolated from a plant in Africa. It's used in traditional African medicine. But you can see how they have some kind of wild and crazy three-dimensional structures. That's the only thing I want to show in the picture here. But there's a lot of interest in cyclic peptides. What we've discovered, then, in a nutshell, is the biosynthetic pathway for how these toxins are made by the mushrooms. This is the precursor. There's a gene in the amanita mushrooms that makes this little linear peptide. In fact, it has to make it with RNA polymerase too, because that's the only way all cells can make messenger RNAs, and then that gets translated, and each letter there indicates one amino acid. We have shorthand codes, and so that's methionine, phenylalanine, aspartic acid, etc. 35 amino acids, that's really tiny for a protein. And then we discovered an enzyme called POPB. Never mind what that stands for. Anyway, what this amazing enzyme does is it takes this 35 amino acid protein, cuts out the little metal piece there, and makes a circle, a cycle out of it. And those are the 8 amino acids that are found in the alpha mannitin molecule. This one enzyme cuts that out and makes a little cycle. It doesn't do the whole thing. There has to be additional steps after that to make the final mature alpha. But this is getting us a long way towards the biosynthesis of it. And I'd like to point out this mushroom, this enzyme, actually we isolated it from Gallerina marginata, one of these little brown mushrooms that makes alpha-manitin. Cyclic peptides are not only very useful, they're very difficult to synthesize chemically. It would cost about $5,000 to make a few milligrams of this compound. Chemical company to make it for us. One of the exciting things about this is now we have a way to make cyclic peptides in the test tube synthetically. And in principle, encoded in the, since these all these amino acids are encoded in the DNA, by making a synthetic gene in which we change the nucleotides, we change these amino acids, and we can put any of the 20 known amino acids into this little region here in this enzyme. We'll cut it out and cyclize whatever we give it. So there are 8 amino acids here, and if there's 20 possible amino acids, that gives you 20 to the 8th power, which is about 25 billion possible cyclic octopeptides you could make using the exact same biochemical machinery that the mushroom has evolved. So basically, amanita, and I have to give Gallerina full credit here too, amanita and Gallerina have evolved a biochemical pathway to make, with the potential to make millions of cyclic peptides. So what we're doing is we're designing a strategy to make libraries of cyclic peptides. We go in and change the nucleotides encoding those amino acids, put it in a test tube, and we pump out libraries. And if we can make libraries of even 500 or 1,000 or 2,000 or hopefully someday, say, 10,000 different cyclic peptides, then we have a very rich source of material that we can use in screening assays against any potential pharmacological target that we want. And some candidate ones will be, say, anti-cancer, antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory. There's an endless number of potential targets where cyclic peptides have been shown in one way or another to be potentially useful. And just to give you a little rose gallery of potential things, we wanted to explore the potential of this enzyme for cyclizing compounds. And so we took little baby steps. We said, can we make little minor changes? So here is the native alpha-manitin molecule with this series of 8 amino acids. And we change one amino acid and we make a new product, we prove we could do that. We could change another position and change and do that. We're making little tiny changes here, but now we're getting more aggressive. We can, for example, not just make 8 cycle octapeptides, we can make deca of the 16 amino acids. Gives us a whole new range of space. We can add unusual amino acids if we do it by chemical synthesis. We can do all sorts of tricks. Notice what we're making, though, are not actual mature alpha-manitin. This does not have that critical cross bridge in there. It doesn't have some of the other modifications, but we still don't understand how that's done biochemically. But we can make new compounds and prove proof of principle that this enzyme is very useful. So the good side of alpha-manitin and the good side of aminotoxins. Antibody-drug conjugates for against cancer, making libraries and millions of novel cyclic peptides for all sorts of potential purposes, and even potentially useful antibacterial compound for these poisonous mushrooms. Finally, I'd like to thank, in particular, I'd like to thank Heather Howland. She is a bona fide mycologist, unlike myself. She was doing her PhD thesis down the hall, using my equipment to analyze these toxins from the mushrooms, and we got to talking, and we realized that no one had ever discovered the genes that make the toxins. And so she and I began a collaboration on this that led finally to the identification of it, which turned out to be a very unusual, interesting story. And Hong Lo did a lot of the work, and Mike Scambler is doing all the work with POTB, showing its capacity to make combinatorial peptide libraries. With that,